I discovered that the law was also all too often corrupted by irrational prejudice and radical artifacts. This study of the Southern judiciary reminds us once again that law and justice are distinct ideas, and that the law is often not what the United States Supreme Court declares it to be, but what the American public accepts or institutional power deems to enforce. So with that, I'd like to give you just an overview here about the John Howard Payne papers. As you know, the first six volumes of the John Howard Payne papers were, here I have my arrow here, were published by Nebraska Press, and they were beautifully edited and annotated by Ann Rogers, who's president of the North Carolina Trilateral Association, her colleagues at Western Carolina University, William Anderson and Jane Graham. And these came out in around 2010. And right after they came out, the University of Nebraska Press and the Newberry Library approached me and asked me, would I take on the, would I publish the rest of the volumes, which are political in nature, volumes 7 through 14, not published, but would I edit and annotate, and then Nebraska Press would publish. And so Newberry Library has given me permission to edit and annotate and publish these documents, and it's been a long process. But as I am going through all these magnificent documents, there are around 2,000 pages of handwritten manuscripts by John Howard Payne. And first of all, before I talk about John Howard Payne just a little bit, to let you know something about the background, his background, I want to show you the picture here of Edward E. Ayer, who was a person who was a railroad magnate, and he took his fortunes and invested in Indian manuscripts, and then in artifacts in the late 1800s. And then he assembled all these artifacts and he gave them to the Newberry Library, which had opened in the 1880s. And as it ended up, it allowed the Newberry Library to have the largest collection of Indian manuscripts and artifacts in any library in the world. Now, he at some point, we don't know at which point, he bought these papers from the descendants of John Howard Payne. We'll tell you about him in just a minute. But he gave these manuscripts to the library in 1911. We don't know how much they cost. We don't know how long he had the manuscripts before he gave them to them to the library. But we just know that they came there in 1911. And I'd like to tell you a little something now about John Howard Payne. John Howard Payne was born in New York. His father was a schoolmaster, and early on he decided he wanted to become an actor. And he attended Union College for a little while, and we're going to find out that John F. Schermerhorn, Schermerhorn. Also went to Union College. But anyway, John Howard Payne wanted to become a thespian, and he ended up leaving the United States, and he found his career in London and Paris. He stayed abroad for about 20 years, made friends with Washington Irving and Mary Shelley, who was the wife of Percy Shelley. And of course, you know, she wrote Frankenstein. So he was with people who had high profiles already around the world. And then he really became known for a lyric that he composed that he actually adapted from a ballet. And he composed this enduring song, Home Sweet Home. And when he returned from Europe and decided to come back to the United States to live in 1832, he heard about the situation of the Indians in the Southeast and the trials and tribulations, obviously, that they were going through. And he decided to make a trip to visit the Cherokees. He got to know John Rawls, and he thought he would write an article in a magazine and edit a magazine about removal or what was going on as far as removal was concerned and the troubles that were facing the Cherokees at that time. And so John Rawls entrusted him with this treasure trove of papers, these papers that had been put together by Sabin Buttrick and Charles Hicks, plus all the letters that John Rawls had been corresponding with the officials in Washington and also peoples in Georgia. He just had a treasure trove of information, and he felt like he could trust this treasure trove with John Howard Payne, and that this treasure trove would not fall into the hands of his enemies, I mean of John Rawls's enemies. And so enemies really being peoples from the United States government. So from there, John Howard Payne, we don't know really where John Howard Payne took all these manuscripts, but obviously he took them someplace and he transcribed these manuscripts. We don't know the odyssey these transcripts really took place, how they took place, and where he went, maybe to the New York City Public Library, I don't know, you know, where he sat and did all this work. And then he was always in debt, and so his friends and family decided that it was a good idea if he became a consulate. So he went to Tunis and Tunisia from 1843 to 1845, and then he came back to the United States again in debt, and then he went back to Tunis in 1851 to 1852, and he died in Tunisia in 1852, and it wasn't until the 1883, the Corcoran family of the Corcoran Art Gallery and all in Washington, D.C., of course, is named for, were also big fans of John Howard Payne. He always had people who were very much, you know, and high profile people who liked him very much and respected him. He was a well known actor and writer, of course, way before he died. And so they brought his ashes back from Tunis and had them reinterred in a cemetery there in Washington, D.C., and with full accompaniment of bands, and it was a huge ceremony. It was in celebration also of his 91st birthday. So this is John Howard Payne, and so we owe John Howard Payne, of course, a magnificent debt for this legacy that he's left us. And we now have these papers at the Newberry Library. I don't have, on this particular slideshow, I don't have a slide of John Schermerhorn, but I wanted to just to tell you how, since John Schermerhorn plays such a huge part in the Treaty of New Echota in December the 29th, 1835, I wanted just to tell you how it came about that he became in charge of the treaty and also of the removal of the Cherokees himself. This is a document from February of 1835. General Richard D. Dunlop of Tennessee received from the president the offer to be appointed joint commissioner with Mr. Schermerhorn to negotiate a Cherokee treaty with John Ridge and his followers. General Dunlop replied that he should be proud of such an honor and such an appointment, but that he could not negotiate with an unauthorized party, that Mr. Ross was the only medium through which a treaty should be obtained. The president replied that Major Ridge, the father of John Ridge, was well known to him, had served him with him in the war. Of course, we're talking about Andrew Jackson now. He served with Major Ridge in the war of the Creek War of 1813-1814. And could raise warriors enough with a word to exterminate Ross and all of his adherents. And this is General Dunlop assured the president that he had been grossly imposed upon in reference to the Ridge Party, that whatever the major's popularity might have been, he was now utterly impotent among the Cherokees, and that, in talking about Major Ridge, and that anyone who professed to have hope of making a treaty through the influence of that family would be guilty of a baseness toward the executive. General Dunlap declined the suggestion of the president, and Mr. Schermerhorn was appointed sole commissioner. It was not long ago, long after the delivery of this letter, when Cherokees from the neighborhood of the Ridges flocked in every day upon Mr. Ross. Now, of course, they were, as you know, they were they had lived at one time in the same area. "Have you joined the Ridge Party," I say. "Have you determined to forsake the nation's cause and to sign the treaty they have offered?" "No." "Why do you ask?" "Because," said Mr. Ross, "because the Ridges say you have." "Well, they tell us. Why attempt longer to resist when even your own chief gives way to us?" So I brought this up just to show you that this will be a back and forth type situation, and there will be a flurry of insinuations from both sides. I wanted to start out, and of course we know it in that the Cherokees end up with this fraudulent treaty. But before this fraudulent treaty is signed, I wanted to go and just show you the what was going on between the people who were working with the Cherokee Phoenix and how all that came about. Now, I think some of you know some of this background, but I have found this background mainly in the John Howard Payne, all this background in the John Howard Payne papers. Elias Boudinot was appointed the editor-in-chief of the Phoenix, and he stayed in that position for 4 years. But in 1832, John Ross became dissatisfied with him, felt like that he should not be giving another side, and this is paraphrasing from some of these papers, another side to the removal process, that he should be only for John Ross and what the council was telling him to put in the paper. And so Elias Boudinot ended up resigning from his position in 1832. And sometime following that resignation, John Ross and the general counsel appointed Hicks to be in charge. Now, but what's going to happen in the meantime is, you know, that the Georgians are coming in constantly on Cherokee land and resources, and there's nothing the Cherokees can do. They have no way of removing these people. So the Georgia Guard will come into play here, and this is in the year around early in 1835. Okay, this is a part of a letter that John Ross wrote to Andrew Jackson. "The next movement of those unfriendly to the Cherokees was by the Georgia Guard, the seizure of the press in which John Ridge was a party. It was seen that all hope of a desire to change the policy of the party was fruitless, and no further step was taken to accomplish a measure which promised evil rather than good. We beg leave again to repeat that on our part we have not any private feelings of animosity nor revenge to indulge against any individual here," this is what John Ross is saying, "nor will we cherish any. Much less in our official acts are we disposed to disturb or injure the individual rights of any Cherokee citizen. And if you harbor any suspicion against the truth of what we say on this subject, we must request the favor of you as a matter of justice to ourselves to communicate frankly to us the reasons and authority upon which that suspicion rests." And I will say that the letters have this type of spirit all along, even up to the very end before this fraudulent treaty is signed in December 29, 1835. The Ridges and the Rosses are trying to work out their differences. But getting back to the press, so in August of 1835, Ross wrote to Benjamin F. Curie, who was another commissioner assigned to enroll Cherokees early on to go west, and he found this job just very, very overwhelming. But he's still among the Cherokees. He's a friend of Andrew Jackson's, and he's from McMinnville, Tennessee. And this is Ross to Curie, U.S. agent. It has been reported to me that the Georgia Guard, headed by Colonel Bishop and accompanied by Stan Waity, have forcibly seized and taken away from out of the house of Mr. Elijah Hicks at New Echota, the printing press and types, various books and papers, and other articles all belonging to the Cherokee Nation. It has also been stated that it was currently reported and believed that this extraordinary proceeding had been performed under your direction in conjunction with that of John Ridge, of course, talking about Curie, who it is said was in New Echota at the time when the seizure was made. In order, therefore, that the facts in relation to this transaction may be correctly known, I embrace the earliest opportunity to address you on the subject and respectfully to inquire whether this report be true or not. So, and then there's another letter from John Ross to Curie and Sherman Horn, and it says, and if correct then, to be informed by what authority or justification you have been prompted to seize this rightful property of the nation. What the object in view is for having it done, and what disposition is intended to be made of the property. It may be proper to add that the General Council of the Nation, which was held at Red Clay, and Red Clay was moved, the center of the nation from New Echota, when the Georgia Guard took it over in 1830, and the Georgia legislature declared it null and void as a capital, they moved for a short time to Chattooga, and I found out that from our Alabama representative, Larry Smith. And then it was moved to Red Clay around in say 1832. This is a few years later, and this is where John Ross is holding his council meetings in Red Clay. It may be proper to add that the General Council of the Nation, which was held at Red Clay in the course of late spring, adopted a resolution directing me to have this property removed from New Echota, and that in pursuance of which I had employed a wagon and team to carry it into effect. But the wagon engaged in this service arrived at New Echota about 2 hours after this unexpected and very singular seizure was made on the property, as herein stated. And then in September, Benjamin Curie writes to John Ross. You can see how interesting this is. It's always a mystery, and the politeness of these letters are remarkable in many ways too. You gave the press into the hands of your brother-in-law, Elijah Hicks. There's been a marriage there with Elijah Hicks, a relative related to John Ross, who was completely under your dictation, and it was prostituted to party politics among yourselves, misleading the common people and prejudicing their minds against some of the best and most patriotic members of this tribe, because they would no longer submit to your dictation. And when they saw you leading them to ruin and destruction by your useless opposition to the measures of the government, Mr. Waity observed, and that's Stan Waity, that since their national government had been dissolved, and Georgia had declared the Cherokee Nation null and void, and the laws of the several states extended over them, he thought that the press ought to be placed again in the hands of Mr. Boudinot and himself, who had originally had the charge of the press and conducted it to the general satisfaction of the Cherokee people, and not to be suffered to get into the hands of a few designing men, Ross's party, that Curie is of course blaming him for, who had assumed to themselves all the power and authority of the Cherokee Nation, and who would only use it to subserve their own interest. You seem disposed to infer that Mr. Ridge, because he was at Newtown about that time, was concerned in moving the press. Let me guard you against the evil tendency of these unfounded jealousies, and as a friend to both, assure you of Mr. Ridge's steadfast determination to meet you on the proposed ground of reconciliation and unite whenever you shall appoint a time as agreed upon to see what had best been done to ensure the salvation of his brethren. So that was Corey at the very end trying to bring about, of course, some type of reconciliation. Now, I want, this is, of course, this is the last Boudinot, and the next picture here is a replica of the press, as you know, that as it stands now in New Echota. And we have here, this is Louis Casper, I'm going to get to him later. Then I'm trying to get to, well, this is John Ridge and Major Ridge, his father, as you know, George Larry, who was, of course, in Sequoia. And I'm looking for John Ross's picture, but we'll wait on that in just a second. By the now I want to to show you the position that the Cherokee Nation is in, because starting in 1833, the Ridges and the Rosses were both sending delegations to Washington City to seek out the President of the United States or Lewis Cass, who was at that time the Secretary of War. And this is a letter that John Ridge wrote to after Boudinot has resigned from editor of the press, and he's writing a letter to the Cherokee citizens. And at this time he's still living in Rome, Georgia, at the head of Coosa, and nearby, of course, of the Ridges. By the authority of the General Council, the advice and consent of the committee, this is the authorized delegation to Washington City. The Cherokee Nation will never consentingly abandon this country to remove west of the Mississippi River. This is a true disposition of the people, that their sentiments on this subject are unchangeable, that by the decision of the Supreme Court of the United States, and of course, Wooster versus Georgia, In the injunction case, the Cherokees are recognized as a distinct political society capable of managing its own affairs and governing itself, and that the United States have recognized the Cherokee Nation as a state, and the courts are bound by those acts. And that is how all of this. Then I want to show you a slide of Cass that's down below here, because some of this correspondence will come from Lewis Cass, who's now the Secretary of War. Going back to the idea of these delegations going and Ross's delegation being the true representative of the Cherokee Nation, because they are meeting in council, and this is the majority of the Cherokees, obviously, that are with Ross, but he sent there a delegation in January, and they come back in February of 1833, and he says, this is an open letter to his fellow citizens, and he says, "It affords me pleasure to communicate to you the safe return of our delegation from the seat of the general government, and in pursuance of duty, I will endeavor to lay before you as briefly as possible their proceedings. Upon the arrival at Washington City, and after the usual salutation of taking the Secretary of War, Lewis Cass, and the President by the hand, and was over, a communication was immediately addressed through the War Department for consideration of the President, touching the various and multifarious claims and grievances of the nation, growing out of the oppressive acts of the state of Georgia and the bad conduct of her citizens." And after remaining in a state of suspension, they would go there and they would stay for days and weeks at the Browns Hotel, which sometimes is referred to as the Indian Queen's Hotel. And anyway, the United States government would keep them in suspense, and they would not have a reply for a while. And this policy on the part of the president to evade a direct reply is no less astonishing than unjust, because the communication embraced several subjects of new occurrences which had never been laid before the government. The Cherokee Nation knows the busy tattlers and intriguers who are ever ready to prey upon our vitals of false insinuations. They will, no doubt, endeavor to persuade you to believe that there is no hope left on this side of the Mississippi. Nay, the coarse voice is even now beginning to be heard, rushing from the forked tongue over the plains, hills, and mountains through the land. Therefore, beware and suffer not yourselves to be deluded by them. You have for the time past, met oppression and injustice with fortitude and forbearance, and I trust, and this is his plea to his fellow citizens, I trust you will persevere in this prudent course, as it will not fail in due time to lead you to a safe deliverance from all the trouble you experience on the cruel and unjust measures passed by the state of Georgia and the president toward us. So now I'm going to turn to the back and forth, and there are just several of these letters, because there's a huge bundle of these letters in the Payne papers. But I just picked out just a couple of letters just to show you some of the what was going on back and forth between the Ridge Party and the Ross Party, or the Treaty Party and the Ross Party. And this has to do now with another delegation and another delegation procession, one from the Ridge and one from the Ross. This delegation has proceeded to Washington City, composed of Major Ridge and Elias Boudinot, citizens of said district, and this is of the Coosawatte district. We are informed that they have proceeded there to form an invitation by the president through Andrew Rawls, of course he's John Ross's brother, in order, as the undersigned concedes, by virtue of their authority, to an agreement for the adjustment of the controversy existing between the Cherokees and the government. In relation to the powers that these persons may claim as authority act, touching our rights, national and individual, we beg leave respectfully to represent through you to the president that they are unauthorized by the Cherokees to represent their interests, and that they have proceeded without the least authority from the great body of the Cherokees to act for them and the undersigned, and that there are over 50 names that they have attached to this letter. Another letter has 517 names. And also that we protest against the acts of the said Major Ridge and Elias Boudinot, and whatever particular they may assume to act with the government as having no authority from us, and touching our national and our personal and national rights. The visits to Washington, the letters to Washington, speedily pick up, of course, after Schermerhorn is appointed in early 1835. And so this is a series of what's happening here. Andrew Jackson to John Rawls in March 22nd, 1835. John Ross and his delegation were well advised before they left here, and I have caused it to be reiterated a few days ago through the War Department that this was my settled determination that happiness is by accepting the treaty on the one hand, and on the other, by its rejection, destruction was before them. That was Andrew Jackson to John Ross. Now, Benjamin Corey, the next month, April 19th, 1835, Benjamin Corey to John Ross. On proposing to cede a country for the removal of its aboriginal inhabitants, past experience has shown there is danger of civil discord and commotion, bloodshed. That patriotic band headed by John Ridge, who was instrumental in eliciting from the executive of the United States these liberal terms. Indeed, I am informed that your representatives to Cherokees, with whom you have had an interview at Mr. Lowry's, and of course George Lowry is in here, here is George Lowry, were of characteristic inconsistent with the facts as they occurred and well calculated to produce an unmerited prejudice against the Misters, Ridge, Boudinot, Smith, West, Bell, and Davis, who are with the Ridge Party. And I think Jay Hanna referred to some of these people this morning. And from these causes, should violence be threatened or death to any of these men or their party ensue, or should any attempt be made to prevent a fair and unbiased expression of their preference for freedom in the West to slavery here, incurable evils to the Cherokees may naturally be expected, for all of which I am directed by the President of the United States to say, you and your council will be held responsible. Now this is Benjamin Corey to John Ross. Now John Ross, and in the meantime, in July and June and July, John Ross and John Ridge write several letters saying that they're going to come together and try to work out some kind of reconciliation, that they're going to have some kind of special council together. Now, Major Ridge and John Ridge to John Ross. And I'll just read that one particular letter. We approve of your suggestion that the most influential and prominent men might hold a special meeting to confer on points in relation to the affairs of our much afflicted nation. We therefore cordially accept your invitation. This is the letter before by Ross. I have not read, but I just told you a little bit about, to hold such a conference at a time and place you shall appoint. And we only add inclusion that we've all desired all along the best of friendship for yourself and others, having in view the ultimate salvation of our oppressed people. So what I wanted to end with here, and I was very much taken with this letter. I don't know who wrote it. There was not a date on it. It was just in one of these multiple folders in this. In volume 7, these are all from volume 7, the first volume in this series that I'm editing and annotating. And so it's just as a letter from one of the oppressed. And I thought that you would like to hear it. I was very much taken with it myself. But before Jay Hanna made a reference this morning to Andrew Jackson looking upon Indian peoples as being his children. I just wanted you to see that. And then I want to go back up to the Cherokee Nation as it stood in around 1830 and what it looked like in around 1830, okay. Be it known, then, that the Cherokees, under existing circumstances, are capable of committing three kinds of sins, namely legal sins, party sins, and policy sins, or, in other words, sins against the law, sins against the party, and sins against the darling policy. Sinners of the first class, in many instances, obtain forgiveness by submitting to the party or policy. But it seems there is no mercy for the two latter, neither in His Excellency at Milledgeville, of course the governor of Georgia, nor in His Majesty at the White House. Now, although it's very difficult for a Cherokee to breathe in this country without transgressing someone or other of the many exterminating laws of 1831 and then, yet everybody knows that we have not violated any law in this matter. What then is the conclusion of the whole matter? This great military outrage was committed upon our characters, our persons, and our property, and upon the civil authorities of the country too, at the instance and for the gratification of a very few conspicuous gentlemen of a certain party, and that in subservience to a beloved policy. Now, in order that the Cherokees might be able to meet the Honorable Commissioner on fair grounds, of course talking about Schermerhorn, it was indispensably necessary that they should know something of the nature and amount of their claims against the general government. What this reminds me of is Lorenzo Dow's poetry. He had gone around in the Southeast in 1820, and he was a red-haired man. He was a firebrand evangelical camp meeting minister. This is Lorenzo Dow. You shall and you shan't. You can and you can't. You will and you won't. You'll be damned if you do and be damned if you don't. And while we're on the poetic strain, we may with great propriety add, man's inhumanity to man makes countless thousands mourn. From the signs of the times, it would seem that there was a secret combination of the powers that be to displace the great and overwhelming majority and to place at the helm of affairs a very insignificant minority as to numbers. It is possible that General Jackson, at whose side the Cherokees fought and bled and died in the field of battle, Governor Lumpkin, who professes to be a disciple of the humane and benevolent Jesus, can glory in the tests and groans and agonies of the unfortunate Cherokees. If not, why keep up such a torturing policy among them? Is it not enough that their government should be demolished and they driven into the wilderness to perish? Must they be pursued even unto death? But it may be these great men are imposed upon by designing agents and aspiring, ambitious demagogues who are hard-hearted enough to keep the agonizing Cherokees on the rack for the purpose of lining their own pockets with filthy lucre. I know enough of the Cherokees to know that all they ask of the general government is to meet them on fair and honorable grounds and settle the matter in a high-minded and gentlemanly way. But if our father, the president, His Excellency, the governor, Mr. John Ridge, Major Corey, and the Reverend Honorable Mr. Schermerhorn have undertaken the Herculean task of making the Honorable Mr. Ridge the prophet, priest, and king of the Cherokee Nation in opposition to the almost unanimous wish of the Cherokee people. One of the oppressed. And thank you very much.